beginning of these days, I like to begin with retrospective. Retrospective that reflects some on the learning from the previous day and take it further in terms of some of the points which couldn't quite be brought out, but which bear emphasis. So yesterday, we began the day with a bit of administrivia, but more substantively with a set of material in which I provided a certain perspective on the role that data collection play within the context of understanding human health behaviors, exposures, knowledge, attitudes, and beliefs. Within this context, I highlighted a straddling role played by smartphones between, on the one hand, the physical context of a person, the world, the person circulating in the external world, and secondly, their electronic world or electronic context. And I noted that smartphones provide this key nexus between these worlds in as much as it relates to an individual. So that person's view of the electronic world is largely mediated these days by a device such as this for many individuals. Their ability to watch Hulu or view Facebook updates, conduct Google searches, to use email, or use Snapchat or Instagram is all conducted via devices, among which smartphones have primacy in place. And therefore, the smartphone is this kind of key mediator and key nexus for this whole electronic context of the person. In the physical world, whilst the person deals directly with aspects of the physical world, picking things up and walking places, the smartphone is used increasingly to understand that physical world. Think, you know, map applications, GPS mapping applications, where you're situating your understanding of where you are via outputs on the phone, for example, or applications which note you, which let you know about nearby people that you know, for example, such as with a growing number of applications that use location-based maps. The smartphone, in some cases, provides translation of things in the external world and helps us be aware of where we are in our relation to the surrounding context. And a growing number of applications use what's called augmented reality to actually overlay some information from knowledge atop of images of the world. So increasingly, there are aspects of our world that our interactions with them flow through the phone, of making our way from A point A to point B, for example. But in both spheres, electronic and physical, our ability to navigate is very centrally situated. More than that, the phone has this ability to encounter and sense aspects of these worlds. Where we are, in some cases with who we're located, how much physical activity we're getting. Again, another thing we often track through our phone, or wearables that accompany our phone. And the phone has this, by straddling into this physical context, it has the ability to sense our interactions with it, our travels, our toings and froings, our levels of activity in that external world, and if we choose to enable it, aspects of our particular day-to-day lives, what we're eating, the phone to get a sense of our engagement. Now, this would all be just conceptually interesting were it not for the fact that tools like Ethica can provide us a pulse of what's going on in both fields. And that's particularly important because what's going on in the physical world has a very material impact on our health behavior and to some degree our health beliefs. So a crumbling set of sidewalks, an availability of a healthy food environment versus an unhealthy food environment, messaging in the external world, in the physical world, contacts between ourselves and others in which we might engage in imitative behavior or be socially conditioned to engage in certain types of behavior that are healthy or less healthy. These aspects of our physical context often have a very big bearing on our behaviors, and in turn can be whispers of them can be captured by the phone, by virtue of where we are and looking up the walkability of that environment, by sensing, for example, other nearby beacons that indicate people within our social circle, by sensing our levels of sedentary behavior and physical activity, and by asking for self-reporting of some kind. So these factors in the physical world affect us, and the phone provides a convenient way to capture information about that, much of it electronically, some of it through self-reporting. Self-report easily in a lower burden way to go to the phone. So that's kind of this red arrow going here. At the same time, our activities in the world, our levels of physical activity, our levels of sedentary behavior, our degree of engagement with healthy food establishments versus less healthy ones, gives us some indication sometimes of our health beliefs, our health attitudes, and to some degree, aspects of our health. For example, if we're down with the flu for a while, it'll be shown in terms of sedentary behavior, mobility, etc. It'll be manifested in the physical world. Conversely, in this electronic context, there's aspects of the discourse, maybe it's vaccine hesitancy on the part of contacts we have in Facebook, or maybe it's Twitter-related messaging encouraging us to engage in support for healthy eating. That may influence our behavior, may shape our behavior. What we find through Google searches may shape our behavior with respect to misinformation or supportive information. So the electronic world also affects us. That's the red arrow going here. But aspects of our beliefs, our knowledge, our attitudes, and indeed our health behavior, are often indicated electronically too. Whether it's a fitness tracking app on Fitbit or Endomondo, or an aspect of what we're posting on Twitter ourselves, or the images we're sending out via Snapchat or Instagram, or what we're choosing to watch on YouTube, often there's clues as to our knowledge, attitudes, beliefs, and sometimes health behaviors, say with fitness tracking, in the electronic world. So both the electronic context and the physical context whisper to our smartphones about what's going on externally that might affect us, might influence us, but also are indicative to a certain degree about our situation, knowledge, attitude. So we saw yesterday, we got a bit of an introduction to Ethica, and much of our discussion yesterday with respect to Ethica was focused on two major areas. Ethica is a system which allows us to define, to monitor, and refine, and to analyze data from fairly articulated studies leveraging smartphones and wearables for provide insight into health behavior, knowledge, attitudes, and beliefs. And to do so with an economy of work. So yesterday, Mohammed in front of us set up a study in it. It's something that could be done in dozens of minutes very readily, in a way that allows us to then gather information from a person directly through self-reporting. We saw that with surveys yesterday. Gather self-reports regarding a variety of things. Maybe it's a tick I found in my body, or subsequently a rash with buttons I can indicate, or that I'm taking my dose of highly active antiretroviral therapy. Maybe it's aspects of my nutritional intake or physical activity. Perhaps it's some aspect of barriers to physical activity in the external environment, and a narrative about why that poses a problem for me. So Ethica provides these surveys as ways of eliciting reporting from a person about their knowledge, attitudes, beliefs, context, etc., their health situation, often including aspects of health conditions or complaints that wouldn't bring them in to a provider, but which may have bearing on their day-to-day functioning or be indicative of their underlying health state. So maybe it's a bout of coughing and wheezing, or a shortness of breath exacerbation, COPD, that a physician might not normally be aware of, but that a patient or a loved one caring for that patient might provide to the phone. So Ethica provides this conduit for collecting that information, but it does so in a way that situates that information. I talked yesterday about how big data is characterized, I think, in a useful definition by four V's. By volume, that's the big in big data. By velocity, it comes in quickly. And indeed, we saw yesterday that it's fairly straightforward for a respondent to fill out surveys multiple times a day. But we also saw yesterday we can set up these sensors. Automatically collected information that might collect much information, of course, today. Very importantly, from yesterday's discussion, is aspects of variety. So we collect, for that same person, a wide variety of types of information. We'll come back to that in a second. And then some of it has greater veracity in the sense that it involves a person, context being sensed, for example, where they are with beacons or outdoors with Wi-Fi, with GPS, in a way that situates where they are in a very precise way. Alternatively, they may take a photo of aspects of nutritional intake, or have their sedentary behavior recorded by a wristband in ways that lend more accuracy than a summary would a month. So here, within Ethica, we can delineate data sources that will quantify aspects of our physical context, physical activity, sedentary behavior, aspects of who we're with as measured by beacons, or what resources we're needing, aspects associated with our physical location, both indoors, beacons, GPS more broadly. We can have data sources that will capture our physical context. We can also have data sources that will capture aspects of our electronic context. Most notably things like screen time, things like app use, things like incoming calls, things like outgoing calls or SMS messages in both cases. And for some studies, that we hinted at today, we've used Ethica plugins, an older technology, to capture things like people's browsing behavior, what sites they were going to, what full page contents of those pages that they went and visited that contained tobacco related keywords. And we actually can see from that what searches they're conducting, for example, on Google. So these whispers of the electronic context and the physical context, which a phone can measure, these are things which Ethoca is equipped to set up. And today, much of the discussion involving Ethoca will be about some of the details of these data sources. What does it mean to collect data, for example, on screen state, whether the screen is on or off? What does it mean for Ethoca to collect information on GPS? How does that work in terms of accuracy? To what degree can we capture aspects of sedentary behavior, for example, perception? So yesterday's data sources hinted at that. We'll go into that in more detail. But much of yesterday was spent on these instruments to ask questions of a person and elicit information from the person. Mohammed didn't have time to go through the various types of questions in Ethoca, but they are legion. So we have questions that are single answer in character, where you pick one answer, questions which involve multiple types of answers for a given person. So you might select different types of personal protective behaviors in which you're engaged, say for vector-borne disease. So I might list long sleeves, long pants, and a hat and avoidance of high, tall grasses and vegetation. We also have questionnaires related to height, where the person can pick their unit. Up in Canada, we have something called metric, which most of the world has as well, but there's still quite a few people here who use the older imperial system, inches, feet, pounds, for quantifying. Ethoca provides special questions that allow a person to pick what units they would like. It also provides a set of questions which allow for picking a count of things where the type of thing that's being picked, like years, is indicated, so units associated with things. Ethoca also provides multimedia questions, videos that can be elicited from a participant, pictures, audio, and visual analog scales that can be set with different gradations. It has information questions, which sounds odd, but which can be used to present information to our participant rather than to elicit it, and a couple other types like barcode scanning, QR code scanning that I haven't mentioned, but are quite useful with consumer products or being able to situate on a certain resource electronically based on something that they see. So we could scan in, for example, a consumer product as by barcode and know, a prepackaged meal someone eating, or know about a consumer chemical product, hairspray that someone's using, to know something about the types of chemicals to which they're exposed on a day-to-day basis. So Ethoca has these questionnaire types, which we looked at yesterday, or these question types that can be embedded in questionnaires. And as Mohammed noted, there's a variety of types of questionnaires. Baseline, so a study entry, eligibility, even see if someone's eligible to enter a study, routine, which are asked during throughout a deployment, study exit, when a person leaves early, different questionnaires triggered by different conditions. I argued yesterday that this is part of what makes Ethoca greater than the sum of its parts, in the sense that rather than just being survey instruments with these automatically collected mechanisms bolted onto it, added on to those abilities as a different sort of feature, they work together. So we can use aspects of what's collected with the electronic instrument, of say someone's location or proximity to a resource like a service dog or to a prosthetic limb. Alan is doing some wonderful work with there you might have a beacon associated, for example, with a prosthetic limb. He's not doing that in his study yet, but it may be a direction we eventually end up going in a later study. So here, we could use the presence of a resource or a certain context to trigger surveys. And those surveys can then be proximate to a point of concern and elicit information in a lower burden way than if we just ask regularly. Surveys, importantly, can also be triggered by a button push in a proactive way. In some of our studies, which we haven't presented, probably won't get a chance due to the abbreviated nature of the boot camp, make central use of that. They use volunteered information, as it were, to elicit information about a community, which is then contributed back to the community. And so there's a community site available electronically for members of the community, and people post items using Ethica, using their buttons to report items which raise community awareness about issues. Maybe it will be vandalism occurrences, for example. So the community's aware of where vandalism is taking place, and maybe engage in community self-regulation to discourage that. Maybe it's aspects of physical activities to physical, or barriers to physical activity, or support for physical activity in the community. And the community, by reflecting on these barriers and supports, can mobilize in a way that helps secure resources to remedy the shortcomings and extend the benefits. So some of our studies have involved data from Ethica feeding in to a community resource that can be browsed more generally by community members and used to help catalyze action. That was great work by Green Catapult at University of Regina in the SMART study, which is available in one of the JNR articles. So Ethica's types of survey instruments and question types can be used for a variety of needs, some of them externally facing to the study, some of them to work hand-in-hand with electronic data collection, in other cases capturing aspect of narrative context, qualitative as well as quantitative context. And Ethica works to leverage the unique power of smartphones to do so in a way that's less burdensome. For example, providing a person with the option of, instead of just providing full text, also providing audio that provides an alternative input method. So rather than typing a narrative, rather than being restricted to typing a narrative or full text, they can also record audio, comments that will serve as a different way of capturing that story that they want to convey. So Ethica leverages these electronic means of communicating information as well as more traditional Likert scale survey instruments, et cetera, visual analog scales to capture participant self-report, and situates that participant self-report by triggering based on conditions, but also cross-linking it with data from that same participant in time as to where they are, with whom they're located, and some aspect of their physical activity or sedentary behavior or context, for example. So that's the broader Ethica context. It's a context which is evolving. Mohammed will be talking with you today or tomorrow about the Ethica roadmap and the growing use of For example, web-based interfaces to Ethica. You saw yesterday the web-based interface for Ethica's, interface for defining surveys, defining studies. These studies can be interacted with by researchers in a very rich way. We saw that yesterday, and we'll see more of it today. In addition to that, a web-based interface to Ethica for participants, which will allow a rich experience for participants through web-based. Now, Mohammed will be talking about that. This interface that we saw yesterday for researchers is one that provides a key asset for learning about learning from the data that's collected by a study, and learning about what's working and what's not working on a given study. It allows you, for example, to monitor adherence levels from different individuals within a study, to examine the survey responses by individuals within that study, both multimedia and with more traditional instruments, and to get a sense of where people are not answering questions or where they're not volunteering sensor data in ways that we might reach out to them, both automatically and via mechanisms that are manual, but where we can craft the messages to be specific to that participant. And we saw that Ethica can leverage this broader context to situate some surveys and survey responses. For example, where people are answering survey questions within the context of geography. And we can also capture the temporal context. Today, we're going to be taking this a lot further. We're going to be going into the data sources that will situate us in both these worlds. The electronic world, things like screen time, app use, aspects of their going out on calls, etc. In the physical world, with things like step counts, Bluetooth beacon, proximity, GPS location, etc. That's a lot of the goal for today. Tomorrow, a lot of what we'll be looking at is also on the analysis side with Kibana, providing ways that a study can, with custom forms, provide dashboards that will keep the study organizers updated with the progress of the data collection for the study using visualizations specific to that study. And this gives us a way of having our fingers on the pulse of a study and sharing that with others on the study team, and down the road, perhaps with as Ethica evolves with participants. So that was a bit of a retrospective on yesterday and a bit of a sense of where we're going. Are there any questions that I could address before we dive into today's content under Mohammed's able guide? Questions more generally about Ethica, questions about material yesterday, questions about the broader context for this sort of data collection? Anything I can answer? The day is early. There's tea and coffee out there. We'll warm you up. At least I didn't put you to sleep yet. That'll be for my later talk today. Today, we're going to be spending a lot of time on the data sources to go to the nitty-gritty of what these data sources mean and how they can be used. This afternoon, I'm going to be talking with you about some of those very important considerations that come to the fore when you're recruiting participants, trying to bring them to the table, when you're trying to promote the study, to make them aware of it. And we're going to be talking as well about human ethics side of things and helping engage in dialogue with human ethics boards that lends them comfort and lends them appreciation within our studies, and the ways in which Ethica fits into the rubric of ethically rigorously conducted work. So we'll be seeing that in the course of this afternoon. But before you you suffer those lectures from me, you'll be in Muhammad's table. Okay. Thank you very much, and I will turn it over to Muhammad's guidance for the next stage. So we're just going to do a changing of the guard here, and we'll get started with Muhammad's Muhammad's presentation. I guess one or two other